probably for you. So just the list of all the groups, are all the groups here? With the group which is not here, raise your hands. So this is the order in which we will go. Just make sure where you are, and so top to bottom and then left to right. So go down and then down the columns. So then the group which is up next, just get ready before your presentation. I hope you have all put your PDFs right now in the computer. Don't do that in the middle. That'll just take time. And so the first group can come down. Is the first group here? Yes, they are. Yeah, come. Chandrasekhar, Harshan Singh, Vishwesharan. Okay. Parth Pratim Prandel, Sanjay Lamba. They're not there. Not there. Okay. Soling Zimik, Sachin Daniel. Okay. Pooja Sharma, Himeoka. Okay. Dinakar Esteban, Amisha Emiliano Shubha. No. Okay. Achishman, Mosher, Akshat, Sridhar. Oh, there you are. Argyadi Pankit, Saurabh Dibendu. Nayan Madhulika, Dolly Soumya Tanvi, Rituparno Saptarshi Indersh, okay. Prashant Ghanbar Srinivas, Ankit, Mayank Umesh Huancho, and Chittaspandini, probably they'll come later, okay. Charu Hansini, Kevin, Vidya Anjan, there, okay, right here. So I might have misspelled your names, I apologize for that. It was also partly spelling correction, which is not my fault. Anyway, so is the first group there? Can you go ahead? So just there's a timer here. Keep your eyes on that. 7 minutes plus 3 minutes for presentation. Just stop at 7. So 3 minutes for questions.
This for moving and this?
This is forward, backward, and this is pointer.
Okay. Okay. Hello. First, our project.
Hello.
I can make this one.
You can use this.
Our project is the modeling and effectiveness of drugs against HCV infection, which is hepatitis C virus. First, we have to define the hepatitis C virus. It is a virus first cloned in 1989. It is very widely distributed in the world. About 3% of the population of the world are infected with HCV. There is no vaccine against hepatitis C yet. Okay, so I will. This is WHO or World Health Organization the leaflet that defined that 1 million people dead each year from disease caused by hepatitis C or hepatitis B virus. And the problem is that people are not know that they are infected until their liver is progressed to more cirrhosis or hepatocellular carcinoma. This is the risk factor for hepatitis C virus infection. You can infected in treatment of anesthetic instruments. You can be infected using blood transfusion before 1989, when the first blood control on the hepatitis C virus was made. For infants that are mother are infected, they may be infected with HCV. Also, injected drugs are more susceptible to infection. And finally, when living with HIV, there is correlation between HIV and HCV. This is a drug approved by FDA. First, the interferon plus ribavirin was the routine for the treatment of hepatitis C virus, and later in 2011, telaprevir and bosibavir are approved drugs for hepatitis C virus. It is a direct acting antiviral that direct act on some protein, which is NS3 of the HCV. And there is a semibivir that accepted in 2030. There is sofosbuvir that affect on different protein, which NS5B, and ombitasvir, which accepted in 2040, which affect NS5A. This is a life cycle. This is the life cycle of hepatitis C virus. We can see there are eight processes. First, the virus is recognized by some receptor on the liver cell. Then it is endocytosis inside the cell. Then the RNA is get out of the protein core. And this process occurs that RNA form different proteins, which are make the viral protein and the RNA. This replication occurs in the membranous web, which consists of host cell and virus proteins. Then the RNA that formed and the protein that formed from the membranous web are encapsulated and give mature virus. Okay, our model is based on this, and Dev will explain it.
This is the model which we try to come up with for the corresponding biological model. So we have three blocks in the model. The V stands for the virons, and the R plus is the RNA, viral RNA, and the P is the proteins, viral for the requirement of virus. So this block R plus and P is inside the cell, and the virus is attacking from the outside the cell. So we have death rates of each blocks in the rates of A alpha, Fi, and the A is the rate at which the RNA is generated, and these are the corresponding rates and which the protein is generated and then again fed back to the virus. So these inhibitors are the medicines actually for the telaprevir and the other medicine which explained before. So actually in our model, the medicine acts on the rates of autoregulation of RNA and the conversion of RNA to protein, that is B and C. So the corresponding differential equations which comes up from this model is this. Here we have three differential equations for the virus, this RNA and protein, and the rates C and B is related to the medicine concentration with these expressions, 10 into exponential of minus epsilon 1 INS3 and corresponding to the other medicine. So these are the results which we got from this simulating this model. So this is without the drug, and the red curve is the viron and the others are corresponding protein and RNA. So here without the usage of drug, you can see it is blowing up. But when we use individual medicines, means either telaprevir or sofosbuvir, you can see that it's not, sometimes it is decaying, but it's not quite effective. But here what we come up with is that the cocktail of medicines give much more better effectiveness against the number of virus. For example, you can see this curve is much more effective, it means showing the effectiveness of medicine, the decay of viruses. So the four plots are for different ones. Yeah.
That was the initial concentration that we used, and then we try to increase the concentration of both drugs, and so that is a saturation level for that. So finally, we modeled the life cycle of HCV, and we tried to see how sofosbuvir and telaprevir act on the life cycle and reduce the viral infection and also the cocktail of drugs. So we found that the cocktail was more effective than the individual drugs itself. So any questions?
Model you had. One question I had, which so I feel like some of the reason why you didn't see maybe the effect of single drugs is because you have this term. Can we go to the equations? There's a P plus R star or R plus. So even if you manage to knock down, let's say, P a lot, you still get virions from the R star. So you could consider other variations of this equation. I mean, this is part of modeling. I think this is a great start. You have to now try other kinds of terms and see what happens, for instance, if you had P times R star or something. Is that more reflective of the process happening? Or is maybe P plus R star is reflective? Yeah. So it would be interesting to compare what happens with single and multi-drugs in a few different situations.
Sure.
Until one is sure what is actually happening. Well, I'm not even sure which is the correct term to use. So that would be interesting. That will build some intuition about when is multi-drug cocktail useful and when is a single drug useful. I think that will be very valuable.
Yeah. So another thing, you know, it would be nice to know that supposing you increased the level, you know, so you have a cocktail and you have two individual drugs, right? So supposing you increase the level of a single drug beyond a certain point, does that have the same effect as a cocktail with, you know,
I'll tell you.
How is it? I mean, you need to quantify that somehow when you use the cocktail, you need to use a smaller quantity has more significant effect than using a larger quantity of a single drug, right? I mean, something like that.
Yeah, that happened actually. Usage of single drug, actually, this is a higher concentration of the drug that we have used. In the case of single drug, whereas in a cocktail, the concentrations were less taken lesser than the individual drugs. So we didn't find much of a significant effect when in the case of telaprevir, but then we didn't actually get a good result for that. But then sofosbuvir actually had a decay in the number of viruses and the proteins as well.
So it would be nice to see things, you know, as a function of the level of which, you know, how much of the drug that you've injected. I think these curves are for a fixed amount that you've injected, right? These are time courses.
Yeah.
These are time courses.
Yeah, yeah.
But it would be nice to see as a function of amount, right?
Okay.
What's the net result?
Okay.
Good.
Yeah. Thank you. Thanks.
Any more questions? Okay, can the second group come over? So while they're setting up, I would suggest the following. If you already not sent the PDFs for poster printing, do it immediately. And I would also request you participate here rather than doing a lot of kusur pusur amongst yourself. Right? That'll be nice.
Yeah. Okay. Hello. Okay. Yeah. Good morning. Essentially, I will be talking about the effect of quorum sensing on persister cells. And the group comprises of myself, Harshant, and Vishwesh will arrive in very short time. So, yeah, moving on. The idea is when you basically expose a population of certain bacteria, you expose them to like antibiotic, not all of them die. And initially, if you see, a lot of them start dying, but later the number of deaths basically, you know, drastically comes down. And at the, after a certain amount of time, you actually see a lot of them actually still not dead. And once the antibiotic activity is done, you can actually see bacteria surviving and, like, you know, in fact thriving. So that that's because like generally in population, in general, certain kind of bacteria tend to have these two type of phenotypes, which they can easily switch between. And one of them grow very fast, like grow regularly, which are which I would just call as normal cells. The other one is called persister cells, and they happen to grow very slow. And for some reasons, I don't understand the actual mechanism, but antibiotics tend to, you know, basically attack, you know, target these cells which grow very fast. So if they don't grow fast, they can't target them. So essentially, the ones that grow very slow essentially end up surviving. So these are called persisters, and probably the phenomenon can't be called persistence, I guess. So yeah, so the idea is, like, you know, this is not like an mutation which is carried over further generation, because, you know, a child born to persister can be a normal one. So that definitely not like in a permanent mutation, it's just a phenotypic switching. Yeah, and then we have heard many times, you know, even during this course of the school, that a lot of bacteria actually use quorum sensing mechanism to interact between same species, and also some mechanism, you know, sometimes they also use it to talk to, like, bacteria of different species. But here we'll use quorum sensing. We'll consider only quorum sensing that, you know, that bacteria use within the same species. The thing is, we have seen bacteria use quorum sensing, and we have seen, like, you know, persistence. The idea was to, like, you know, how about we club them? So before, I mean, when we actually came up with this idea, we never looked into literature and checked whether such thing exists. But while Ashant was presenting, people said that it does happen. Yeah, which is good. Even if it doesn't happen, then it's not a very far-fetched thing to imagine how about, like, you know, these two, you know, basic mechanisms existing together. And let's see what is the effect of quorum sensing on persistence. So this is what we tried to sort of, you know, check and analyze, essentially. Yeah, so this is the most complicated diagram I have in the talk. So this is like there are two types of cells. I take a population of cells, and they can be either a normal cell or a persister. And I have considered like a stochastic individual based stochastic simulations. So it's about, like, so I consider each individual, and each individual, irrespective of whether a normal or persister, there are three events that can happen in their life during the course of simulation. One is they can divide. Two, in the presence of bacteria, they can die. I won't consider natural death, which occurs without even the presence of antibiotic, but I would, like, let's say the timescales which I'm considering are not very large. In that case, I can eliminate the chance of they dying just of natural causes. So they die here only because of antibiotic. Two, they divide. And as I said, persisters will divide. The doubling time for persister will be much, much, much larger than what it is for normal ones. I mean, that is what essentially helps them to sort of survive. And they can switch between the states. Basically, they can go from normal to persister and persister to normal. In the past, people have considered only, like, constant switching rates between the two states. So that's a stochastic switching, but the rates are constant, essentially. So here, obviously, we are considering quorum sensing. The persister to normal switching wouldn't depend on any sort of population or, like, you know, density of persisters or density of normal. It will be just a constant switching rate. But from normal to persister, we kind of introduce a non-linearity by actually being not just dependent on not just a constant rate, but also a term that is due to, I mean, that is kind of, like, you know, proportional to the, you know, the fraction of persisters which are already in this population. So that's how we sort of, so the idea is that, you know, auto-inducers, whatever, the, you know, that are secreted by persisters, like, you know, that's basically distributed uniformly in the medium. So everyone is sensing, you know, sort of a public good, which is auto-inducer. So we don't have to, like, you know, explicitly use auto-inducer, but we just say that, you know, the amount of auto-inducer present is just proportional to number of persisters, fraction of persisters in the population. That's the idea. Okay. Okay, that's a mistake. That's P by N. Okay. Sorry. Yeah, that's P by N, sorry. We also came across another paper which basically said the sensitivity can be actually kind of heterogeneous. I mean, not every bacteria can sense autoinducers like to the same extent. So we just like, you know, there are these two terms, the alpha I and beta I. Beta I's, we just sample them from a Gaussian distribution with very small, you know, with finite variance. For the sake of this, I've kept like very small variances. So probably it's not just heterogeneous, but then again, one can actually vary this, you know, heterogeneity level and see whether that has any influence and further on. But a lot of things that we can play around in this model. But and exact simulations have been performed using the Dubb-Gillespie algorithm. So yeah, so there are if there are n individuals, then there are 3n possible events. Then I calculate the propensities. Then wait for and calculate the time and when the next event happens. Then I decide which event is going to happen. Yeah, the usual Gillespie stuff. Yeah, so this is a curve which people who study these kind of phenomena look at. This is called killing curve. That is when so basically at t is equal to 20, I turn on the antibiotic. It's like the antibiotic is considered as a binary variable. It's either on or off. I am not considered like, obviously it's very unrealistic, but for the time sake, this model sake, we take like binary variable for antibiotic. It's either on or off, and it's on. It turned out at 20, and it is turned off at 60. Okay, so which is like the end of simulation, and you can see that there is an initially they exponentially rise. So we can just focus on the black curve, which is just the combined population, the persisters and normal combined, and you can see that. Okay, it's okay, just one moment. Yeah. So then you can see that it's decreasing. Then this is when there is quorum sensing. Well, I haven't not like, you know, done a lot of simulations and basically taken the average, but this is like a typical curve, and you can see that it decreases slower than the other one. Convincing, I guess. But I mean, then again, I didn't do many simulations. Okay, and then this is about like, you know, what if like I turn off the, you know, antibiotic, but later ask it to sort of evolve, and you can see that, you know, these populations recover, and you can actually see there's, you know, all three of them existing. The same thing happens even for like quorum sensing. So qualitatively there is not much difference. Quantitatively there is difference, but to quantify that, you need to like do a lot of trials and basically take the average, which I haven't done here. And we wanted to see whether is there any fluctuation. So essentially, what we did here is like, you know, take a small at one particular small time bin. We basically sampled some points and we took the average, and we did it like, you know, two different points in the curve for quorum sensing, you know, the one with quorum sensing and without quorum sensing, and we saw how does the fluctuation depend. With quorum sensing, does the, you know, qualitative nature of the fluctuation differ? But it turns out that, you know, both of them are very similar at two different places. So essentially, conclusion is we tried quorum sensing, which is we saw whether anything interesting will come out of this. But qualitatively, there's not much difference. Not much happening. Of course, we didn't get anything spectacular. Yeah, and these are those references. Yeah, thank you.
You know, if you show us those curves again, before that, yeah. Killing curve without, yes. So if you look at this, I'm just a bit puzzled as to why initially the red and the green are growing at the same rate, isn't it?
Yeah, what I do here is I start with like entire population, which is just normals, because there is anyway finite switching rate. So I don't have to worry about starting with some amount of persisters. As you can see, it starts from zero. But then again, they rise, and they do rise. The point is, like, if normal is growing fast, even the persistence grows slow. But the point is, there is a flip, you know, you can switch from normal to this, and that is proportional to how many normals are there. So in a way, effectively, they grow at a very comparable rate.
Later on also, while there is an initial decline in the persisters, in the normal cells.
Yeah.
Again, the rates become the same, right? The curves become parallel to each other.
So that is true. But then again, is there a laser here? Oh yeah. So the thing is, if you see this section, this very fast decline doesn't exist for persisters. That's the only difference. Yeah, this is where there is not, you know, almost like a, they fall from almost a decade.
Yes. So do you know if this is actually observed? I mean, the fact that eventually, so this is because of the switching between the two.
Yeah.
They are in some kind of an equilibrium between each other, right?
Yeah.
Somehow. Is this sort of consistent with the experimental?
The one paper, the Balaban's paper, where they have these killing curves, in a way, they're, you know, very qualitatively, they look the same. I mean, I won't put the plot, but they look pretty same. Okay. So this is what we did.
Other questions? Okay, let's thank them. Parth Pratim Pandey, Sanjay Lamba, Prabhat Shankar, Hadise, and Vivek Rai.
Yeah. This is the pointer center one.
Hmm.
Okay.
Okay, and left right.
This is the left one. Okay.
Okay. Okay. Hi. Good morning, everybody. So, in our group, we are Sanjay, Parth, Hadith, and myself. I was not supposed to present here. Other people should have presented, but I think we all had a very good experience working together. And the problem last time we chose, we talked about chromosome number for how many sexes there should be optimally, but we found that problem to be a bit abstract. So we thought about changing the problem statement, and we are today presenting our small simulation work on response merge relation in persistence systems. So what is persistence system? Persistence detection means, like, sometimes, like, cells, they sense various signaling molecules from outside. So if they change the concentration in the molecule, they sometimes respond to it. So for example, if there is a step change in the concentration of outside, they can, like, if there is a step change, they can sense that change and they can respond to it appropriately. But many times it happens that the cellular system, the outside environment of the system, contains many fluctuations. So the cell has to make a decision whether the fluctuation is just random or it actually corresponds to some meaningful change in the outside environment. So for example, if there would be a small fluctuating change, then this change would be very small. If the cell responds to it, it would be wastage of its energy and function. So persistence detection means that if the cell, if the change in the outside concentration persists for a long time, means long enough time, the threshold depends on the system parameters, if it can detect such a persistent change, then it responds to it. But if the output change, if the change in the outside environment is too small, like too small is again relative term, if it's too small, then the output has no change at all. This is the intermediate variable, this is the output variable. So there is no change in the output in the small change in the environment, and there is visible change. So this is persistence detection in the cellular system. So it was shown in the Uri Alone book that persistence behavior is shown by coherent feedforward loops. So we know that there are a lot of network motifs. There are coherent feedforward loop, there are incoherent feedforward loop, negative feedback, positive feedback. So in a coherent feedforward, what happens is x is the input, this is the output. So this is positive, this pathway is positive, positive. So the sign of all the pathway is similar, positive, positive, positive. So there could be negative, negative, negative. So if the sign of the two paths is same, that is coherent. If the sign of the two paths is different, like this is positive, positive, negative, this is incoherent feedforward. So coherent feedforward, there are four types: positive, 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 negative, positive, negative. So these four configuration, all of them can show persistence behavior. So all of them can show, we focus on just a coherent positive feedforward loop in our case, and we have currently not studied the other three. So in the coherent feedforward loop, as I mentioned, that there is the input, this detects the input. So this is positive activation, positive, positive. This is coherent feedforward loop. And the change in the signal persists for a long time, then the output should show a change in its corresponding concentration. So for this type of loop, different type of equation can be written. So we choose for our case, so in the persistent system, what is happening is this is activation, activation, activation. So this and this, both of them should be on for a persistent behavior to be shown. So we choose this Hill type of function. In our Y is the intermediate variable, Z is the output variable, and this is the Hill type of function. And X is the input, Y is the intermediate. X can activate the intermediate, and Z is activated by both the input X and the intermediate Y, and this is the degradation rate. So this equation is simpler to understand, that Y is activated by the input X, Z is activated by both X and I made a mistake. This is Y here. This should be Y. So it's a mistake in the, so X Y. So this equation, so we can, the parameters are beta by, beta y, alpha y. So these parameters, they can be chosen randomly. So just for a select random set of parameter, we simulated the differential equation, and to the system, we provided the pulse input with a big threshold, another pulse input with smaller duration, and another pulse with very short duration. So we saw that the green line is the output. The output is shown if the persistence, if the change in input is large, and here there is no change in the input. So this, we verify that persistence is being shown. So if the problem of our interest is, we are interested the chemical systems have fluctuation inherently in them. For example, the around the mean there is fluctuation. So our interest is we can quantify this fluctuation. So what is the relation between response of the system and the fluctuation in it? So for this system can be studied if we calculate the response using a differential equation by simulating the deterministic, we can compute the deterministic response. And for computing the fluctuation, we can calculate the noise using the Gillespie algorithm. So we run this simulation for which randomly choose 1000 point. I know 1000 point is small. We should ideally choose maybe 1 million parameter, but it takes a lot of time. So for Gillespie simulation, so this is 1000 parameter, and we, here is the noise, and here is the response, and this is log scale, and I plot the density. So this density means this red means maximum density. So most of the parameter fell here, which means that most of the parameter have response value which is very low. So if I summarize, the interpretation of the above graph is many parameters that have very less response, and response is less than fluctuation. So here, this line is the inequality, response is less than fluctuation. And just for the sake of comparison, I had obtained some result for adaptation system. There also this inequality is whole, but the response is slightly larger for some values. So maybe this is the preliminary analysis of coherent type 1 feed forward loop. And in the future, we would like to study the relation between persistence, the detection threshold, fluctuation, and response. And we want to extend the analysis for other three type of coherent feed forward loop and see if there is any noticeable or important difference between them. So thank you very much. Yeah.
Persistence in time. I mean, they could also think about the persistence in, if you have a very sharp and very large.
Yeah, it persistence in time, because if there is if it's so persistent, then for
if you go back to your graphs, so you showed one simulation at the the third one looks like a sharp peak, but it's of a small magnitude. But if the magnitude was very large,
look at this. I mean, I'm just interested in the comparison of this. What would the graph have looked like for not a coherent feedforward thing, but just a straight just a straight input-output connection. I imagine even there the output has some rate at which it goes up. So if the input is not there for very long, if there is some limiting rate, something that limits the rate at which the output can go up,
actually there
that may also give you a time scale of, you know, a certain time scale over which you need the
above which
input to be there.
Yeah, okay, perhaps, yes.
So, but this is interesting because I think it gives you some general intuition about, you know, a class of circuits. What would be required for something to respond only to a fat thing rather than a small thing?
And yes.
Something to do with limiting the time scale. And right. this is one way. But it's possible you could extend your results to
other, even simpler networks, perhaps.
What kinds of things limit this sort of the climbing of the output?
Right.
So the question was posed very nicely. I mean, what is the relationship between response and fluctuations? I mean, in equilibrium, there's a very nice statement.
Yeah, in equilibrium, there is the fluctuation dissipation theorem. But for non-equilibrium, it's not clearly understood. So.
Very good. So let's thank them.
Thank you very much.
So next group is Soling Zimik, Sachit Daniel, Abhishek Mishra, and Yagi Goswami.
Sorry? This is a laser. Okay. This is a laser.
Where are the other people of the group?
So I'm Yagik and he's Abhishek. And
Sachit and...
Yeah, he had a poster to present and Soling had a lab meeting, so they couldn't be here today, this time.
Okay. Hello.
So I'll... I'll begin. We are essentially looking at how crowding in cells or in the cell cytoplasm affects various processes. In particular, we'll be looking at protein folding. So proteins are basically polypeptide chains, They have a 3D native state or a structure, which basically determines their function. And this structure is mostly determined by the sequence of amino acids. In some cases, proteins misfold or they aggregate to form clumps of proteins, and this prevents them from performing the function and is therefore harmful. So basically, macromolecular crowding is an accumulation of proteins, polysaccharides, other large molecules in the cell cytoplasm can achieve these kind of concentrations. And they affect what sort of observations you make in vitro versus in vivo, because they can affect certain things like reaction equilibria and the rates of reactions. They can cause anomalous diffusion within the cells, among other things. So what we'll be looking at mostly is stability in the presence of crowding. Essentially, each molecule has an excluded volume, which is the volume that other molecules cannot occupy around it. And this affects, in turn, the chemical potential of the cell fluid, and essentially because no two volumes can occupy the same space, higher amounts of crowding favor conformations with lower excluded volume. And this, as we will see, has an effect on protein folding. So we should note that crowding does not change which conformations are more stable, but it increases the differences in energy, steepens the energy barriers, and as a result, it will push reactions one way or the other. In this case, it will promote protein folding, and on the other hand, it will also promote aggregate formation, because both these processes sort of reduce the excluded volume of the product molecule. We should note that the overall effects are basically context specific, which is to say that it depends on which protein we're talking about, what you're crowding the cytoplasm with, among other things. So we thought of looking at sort of a very simple toy, so to speak, model by which we can show a variety of different phenomena in different contexts. So essentially, our model is a reaction with intermediates where the final concentration can be given in terms of the concentration of the initial and the intermediates. So we will now look at how crowding will affect various rate constants. So we know that the steric effects will slow down the backward rates by increasing these energy barriers. It may increase or also may not affect the forward rates. But overall, what you would expect to see in equilibrium or the equilibrium concentration of product protein we'd expect to see will be basically with these changes to the rates, where the backward rates are reduced and the forward rates may or may not be increased. So essentially going to show that crowding will promote folding to the native state. So now we look at the formation of aggregates. So aggregates are basically formed by partially folded intermediates. So not all intermediates can form aggregates. The native state typically do not form aggregates, and neither do the initials. But if we look at which intermediate forms the aggregates, then it tells us that basically what the net effect of crowding would be in such a system. So for example, if the first intermediate is forming the aggregate, then crowding will promote basically the effect of crowding towards aggregation will be in these rate constants. Whereas if it is formed from this aggregate, then it will be in all of these rate constants as well. So if you look at the first case and the second case, the relative effect of crowding on folding versus on aggregation, in this case it is more pro-folding, and here it is more, basically this much is common to both folding and aggregation, whereas this one is basically only aggregation. So the conclusion would be that if an early intermediate forms the aggregate, then overall you would expect crowding to be pro-folding, whereas if a later intermediate forms aggregation, you would expect it to be, you know, pro-aggregate depending on what KF4 is versus KAG. So the last thing we looked at was basically molecular chaperones. They use ATP and they assist in the folding of proteins, and they do this in successive cycles, basically taking proteins in and releasing them. So what this means is that in the course of a protein folding in such an intermediate step reaction, it enhances all the forward rates and reduces the backward rates. It also isolates these proteins from whatever surrounding them, and it prevents aggregation as a result. So we look at what chaperones will do. So for example, if the chaperone binds the A1 intermediate, it will increase all the forward rates over here and decrease all these backward rates over here, as well as this one here, by not releasing it. Whereas KF1 will remain the same. But if you look at this case, then the effect of the chaperone is only on 1, 2, and this third rate constant. So as a result, early binding of chaperone, or the chaperone binding the protein early, you would expect would have a greater effect on the overall concentration of folded protein. So we want to look at what now chaperones would do in the context of, say, a protein where an intermediate can form an aggregate. Yeah. So essentially, if the chaperone binds early, you can actually prevent the formation of an aggregate. Whereas if the chaperone binds a later intermediate, this aggregate is already forming. So the effect is indirect, as in you reduce the equilibrium concentration of A1 by changing these rate constants. But the effect is not as much as the first case. OK, so I will skip. Actually, no, I don't have to. So basically, increased crowding will prevent proteins from drifting away from the chaperones. So proteins go through more successive cycles and can fold better. Also, crowding can help chaperone sort of grab the protein just as it's being translated from the ribosome. And this means that basically you'll be getting the protein at an early intermediate versus at a later intermediate. So we have here the fact that aggregation promotes both folding and crowding, but aggregation is prevented by chaperones, which is what which can explain how people see that the net effect of crowding on, say, enzyme activity is not monotonic. So an interesting to look at, mostly motivated by the fact that sort of in vitro results and in vivo results do not seem to be the same, is that can crowding regulate the activity of chaperones in any way, as in the concentration of chaperones in the cell, et cetera. And the next thing, of course, is to look at a more meaningful, more detailed model, where you look at things like misfolded proteins, multiple aggregates, and of course, enzyme activity, where this is the final product. And this is a diffusion-limited rate constant. So we'd be looking at things like subdiffusion, which are also affected by the concentration or crowding. And of course, you want to look for experiments that actually have data that are specific to these questions. And we want to ask, finally, can you actually explain the effect of crowding and of chaperones in terms of a simple reaction with intermediates type model? And that's it. Thank you. So basically, we're looking at the concept of excluded volumes. So excluded volumes are basically if you have a sphere, how much it excludes. A high molecules with higher excluded volumes, they tend to increase the chemical potential by basically making atoms stick closer together when they wouldn't want to. But what happens is that if you fold these, or if they are in more compact forms, this will basically reduce the chemical potential. And what you would see is that these conformations which take up less space are favored. So in this sense, crowding sort of forces proteins to fold into compact shapes.
I just noticed that in the reaction schemes you gave, you have an irreversible reaction to aggregation. Is that because the disaggregation is on timescales you're not interested in? The reason that troubles me a little bit is in the long run, therefore, in any of these schemes, whether there's, you know, whatever rates you use, whether crowding affects those rates or not, eventually everything has to flow into the aggregate. Because that's the only place where things don't flow back out. So the final steady state of this reaction, if you run it for long enough, will be the aggregate no matter what. But perhaps you're not interested in that long run. Maybe you're interested in time scales that are shorter. I just wanted to
get So actually what you said is probably, I mean, it's the way we're sort of thinking about it. This is mostly motivated by the fact that studies that looked at aggregate formation, they talk about basically aggregate accumulation and how it leads to diseases like Alzheimer's and Parkinson's. So yes, on the timescale that we are looking at, aggregates, this backward reaction rate constant is small. Also, we're not talking about how aggregates basically go outwards. Aggregates could be broken down into just simple amino acids. It may be ejected from the cell. It should not, in principle, be a backward arrow. It would be a further outward arrow. But yeah, essentially, we've simplified and said that this is a sort of sink in which you put available proteins.
Okay. Anything else?
This is for the purpose of what we are talking about. This is just the folded protein, which is what we'd use. But if you look at the end over here, So if you look at this over here, basically we have the folded protein which performs an enzymatic action and gives you a product. So this sort of reaction is it could be transcription, it could be basically anything that the protein does. Whereas this K-cat is K-catalysis, which will involve the rate at which this catalytic reaction takes place. It will also include, since we put a single arrow, it will also include how fast this folded protein would diffuse, among other things. So yeah, in this case, we're thinking of this as irreversible, but then again, that may not be the case.
Okay, so let's thank them. Next group by Pooja, Yusuke, Chandrani, Chaket, and Namika.
Good morning, everyone. So the idea of our project was to identify some metabolic properties that could explain the property of pathogenicity. And the idea was to look for metabolic differences in pathogens and non-pathogens. Okay. This is... So the idea was to compare metabolic properties in pathogens and non-pathogens and to see if there are any differences at the metabolic level. For this, we selected five organisms, and these are known to be E. coli, there are two strains of E. coli which are known to be pathogenic and non-pathogenic, and the three other organisms are known to be highly pathogenic. So we wanted to see if there are any differences in the structural and functional properties of these organisms within the two strains and across the organisms. So how do we what properties were we looking for? We took some various different conditions, such as minimal carbon food sources, some knockouts, oxygen sensitivity, nutrient sensitivity, etc., and some other structural properties, which we analyzed through graph theoretical analysis. So in the structural analysis, we took some four properties, the betweenness, centrality, degree, clustering coefficient, and coreness. And the idea was to look for some strikingly different properties in the pathogens and non-pathogens. So before I show the results, I would like to comment here that we did not observe any major differences in the either in the structure or in the function. So you could see that for the Pseudomonas putida, this result is quite an outlier. But that's just because we have not taken the normalized centrality numbers. So this is just because of the small size of the organism. And the rest of the strains are this is the number of reactions, and this is the value of the centrality. So you could see that there is a very narrow distribution of centrality, and even the reaction numbers, the number of reactions are quite similar. This is the graph for the clustering coefficient. And similar, we see similar, very similar results for clustering coefficient as well. This is coreness. So coreness is a property which tells how robust the network is. It looks for the modules of the highest degree, highest size, and see the presence of modules indicates that the network is robust and adaptive, that if you could take one node out, the network would still work. So that was our idea here, and the results are not that different for this case too. And this is the degree distribution. And here we have not considered the currency molecules, the ATPs and GTPs, those kinds of molecules, because that would have shown us the power law behavior. So these are a basic summary of the structural results. These are the number of reactions with the different organisms with, versus the measures taken. We used to look for functional properties. We used flux balance analysis in COBRA and used COBRA's off toolbox. So the flux balance analysis is used to identify the flux distribution of the reactions in the network. And we optimize the biomass function, which stands for, which would give us the growth rate of the organism in different conditions. So this graph is for various these nodes reaction ID. These are the reaction IDs for different minimal carbon food sources, and a few reactions, few food sources stand out here whose growth rates are a bit higher. So the idea was to see if these reactions are common in different organism strains, and also if they come up in the structural analysis part, if they have a very large, significantly larger structural measures within the organism. So this is for the non-pathogenic strain, and this is for the pathogenic strain, and you could see that the food sources are actually they are the same. The same food sources have the same similar values of maximal growth rate, so not much of a difference there. And this is for the other non-pathogenic strain putida. So the future direction. I mean, one conclusion we could make out was maybe we can't see a very different properties here at the level of metabolism, and we would we would need to put in regulatory mechanisms here, regulation, to see or observe any major changes, major differences.
I have one question. Could you go back to the first few slides? Any of those centrality, those structural measures? I don't So just two questions. I couldn't follow the colors. Which is the one that is this one on the left and bottom, the one that seems to be in most of the measures fairly different from
this
the
other? Pseudomonas.
Pseudomonas, okay. So I guess my one question was, that seemed to stand out somehow from the other.
Yeah, but that stands out just because of its much smaller size than the other organism.
Okay, so that's why it's standing out. Why. Okay. And my other question was, I don't have much intuition about these measures. Yeah. Do you have any idea what this distribution and so on would look like for
a
randomized version of these networks with the same degree distribution?
A randomized version would not give you a power law because that would not be a scale-free network. And metabolic networks have a lot of hubs. And the presence of hubs indicates that you have some nodes which have a very significantly higher degree than other nodes. So a large number of nodes would not have will have a small degree, and a small number of nodes would have a very high degree.
So suppose I did a randomization where I preserved the degree distribution. Do you have any?
So you would not have hubs there, and you would not get a power law degree distribution.
I'm saying do a randomization which preserves the degree distribution. Where the
preserves the degree distribution.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you have any idea what it would look like? Is this, I'm trying to get a sense of, is this, has this
degree distribution
different from that random network or not?
So if we preserve the degree distribution, then what are we doing?
But randomize the links.
Okay.
But randomize the network, but preserving the degree distribution.
Okay.
Keep the degrees of every node the same.
Yes.
But rewire who?
The connections, yes. Yes.
Would these measures that you get from that, do you expect those to be very different? I mean, that might be a way of sort of teasing out what is particular about these networks.
Right.
Different from a random network.
Okay. Yeah, maybe what she's saying is ki the identity of the nodes we would lose. Yeah.
Would differ from non-pathogens by some subtle effects,
right?
You know,
yes.
So some pathway in the metabolism has gotten transformed,
yes.
And maybe therefore global measures,
right,
wouldn't show this. Wouldn't show the difference between pathogenic and non-pathogenic bacteria. But there could be
the one analysis, the experimental analysis that's known to differentiate pathogens and non-pathogens are the identification of virulence factors. Those are the proteins or genes which, when knocked out, which when not present in the same strain, would not would actually make the pathogen make the organism non-pathogenic. So these virulence factors are what contribute the pathogenicity to an organism. So that part is known. So we were actually planning to compare our knockout experiments with that set of virulence factors for each strain. We could not get to it. Nodes are the reactions. This is a unipartite, so we converted the bipartite network of a metabolic, this is a reaction unipartite graph.
So E. coli and Shigella are quite sort
very, of... Very, very similar, yes.
So in some matrix, you see that E. coli and Shigella are very close to each other, but in some, you do see a difference. So I don't know how significant that is or what it means, but like maybe if you go to the next metric of... I think there was one which...
E. coli, which one?
So if you compare non-pathogenic, pathogenic E. coli and Shigella,
yes.
I think Shigella was different in some metrics.
Yes.
No, so here it looks, I don't know, it looks similar, but.
Yeah, I mean, there may be some fluctuations because here the reaction number is very low. So maybe that's why.
The two greens and the, I don't know what that color, maroon or what, pink. Yeah.
This? So this is pink one is the Shigella. And E. coli non-pathogenic is this one. So for very, when you cross a significant threshold for the number of reactions, you start seeing the similar behavior. And for maybe here, a few reactions have a slightly different.
No, I don't mean in this graph. I think in one of the metrics, like, yeah, probably here.
Okay. Yeah, this coreness property is actually used for identifying if the network has any modules. Here, E. coli non-pathogenic, and yeah, they have a little bit of difference here, right?
So next group by Dinakar, Esteban, Amrisha, Emiliano, and Shubha. No one?